Good morning, Christ Church. It is such a pleasure to see all of you here for worship this morning on this beautiful first Sunday of August. I have a couple of really quick announcements for you. The first one is, my name is Beth Rambikur. I serve you as your pastor. I serve in ministry here with all of you. So if there is something that you long to be doing, please let us know and we will make sure that you get plugged in. We have a couple of really exciting things coming up. The first one is our August book study on Susanna Wesley, mother of John and Charles. And for those of you who are new to the United Methodist Church or kind of new to history in general, Susanna Wesley and John and Charles Wesley are the founders of the United Methodist Church. So we trace our heritage back to them, and then they trace their heritage back to Jesus. So that's how that works. Anyway, it's gonna be on Wednesday nights on Zoom. We hope that you will join us. And for those of you who are already planning on joining us, please, if you feel like it, dive into the first four chapters, because we will be talking about the history and some questions on those first four chapters. However, reading is not mandatory. You can come and have a great time, even if you don't get the book. So those are all the announcements on that. Also, coming up in September, if you read the channel, we will be starting a book study on Exclusion and Embrace by Miroslav Volf. It's going to be incredible, led by Don and Janet Wagaman. I have to say, I haven't been this challenged by concepts since seminary. So I'm really excited to do that challenging work with them and with all of you. Please, if you are ready to do something new and challenging, especially in a time of election when conflict is on the rise, this will be a good study for all of us to do together. So those are our two book studies, one starting August 7th, which is next week, the other one starting September 11th, which is a month from now. And then our pool party is happening next, Karen Messmore, help me out, or Janet, it's happening this coming Saturday, so not yesterday, but the one that's coming up, on the 10th at 5 p.m. Highland Vista, which if you just go down Craycroft to 7th Street and you turn right, it's a left that's right there off of Woodland. It's off of Woodland. So it's going to be fun. If you are bringing a little kid, please know that minors under the age of 12 need to definitely be accompanied by an adult. And please bring any of your kiddos. We're going to have a great time. And you can come too. It's open for the entire church family. So bring your own beverage. Come and have a good time. What have I forgotten, church family? Oh, of course. Today is Communion Sunday. Communion Sunday in the United Methodist Church is a celebration of God's grace and His invitation for us to experience reconciliation with each other. You do not need to do a thing to celebrate communion in the United Methodist Church. All you need to do is come up and have a party with God and seek in your heart for transformation and forgiveness. So please know that you can do that. If you're joining us today online, now would be a great time to grab something that you can eat and drink with us so that you can participate in this most excellent of festivals with us. And now, my friends, I think that's all I've got. Fabulous. In that case, let us worship together.
Please stand as you are able for the call to worship. All creatures great and small. And calls us to care for each. So turn from anger, sin, and fear. Please be seated and join with me, please, in the opening prayer. Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, you offer us abounding grace and steadfast love. When we experience anger and frustration, teach us to embrace your compassion and understanding. Open our hearts to your presence as you open the hearts of Jonah and the people of Nineveh. Amen. And now let us read Psalm 14 responsively. Fools say in their heart, "There is no God." They are corrupt. They do abominable deeds. There is no one who does good. They have all gone astray. They are all alike perverse. There is no one who does good. No, not one. There they shall be in great terror, for God is with the company of the righteous. Oh, that deliverance for Israel would come from Zion.
Thank you.
The next scripture reading consists of the last 11 verses of the book of Jonah. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, "O Lord, is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning. For I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishing. And now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live." And the Lord said, "Is it right for you to be angry?" Then Jonah went out of the city and sat down east of the city and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade, waiting to see what would become of the city. The Lord God appointed a bush and made it to come over Jonah to give shade over his head to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the bush. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the bush so that it withered. When the sun rose, God prepared a sultry east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah so that he was faint and asked that he might die. He said, "It is better for me to die than to live." But God said to Jonah, "Is it right for you to be angry about this bush?" And he said, "Yes, angry enough to die." Then the Lord said, "You are concerned about the bush for which you did not labor and which you did not grow. It came into being in a night and perished in a night. And should I not be concerned about Nineveh, the great city in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also many animals?" This is the word of God for the people of God.
Today we handle the very last chapter of Jonah, which means that over the last 3 weeks we have gone from watching Jonah receive the first word of God and flee to Tarshish, to being delivered by a fish to Nineveh and proclaiming to Nineveh that the word of God would come against the people and destroy that city. And all the people turned and repented. And now we hear the stunning conclusion, which is actually quite anticlimactic. While I don't remember any of the specifics, I know I threw temper tantrums as a child. Any of you ever throw a temper tantrum anytime in your life? Oh, sure. Not many, I'll tell you. I didn't throw very many. In fact, when I read this to my mom, she was like, "What? You threw temper tantrums?" I was like, "Yes." But the few I threw merited the parental sit-down, which was not memorable to my parents, but it was memorable to me, and the conversation would range about appropriate behavior in public. But these temper tantrums were wildly outrageous affairs that involved language and actions, much like we see from Jonah today. I would cry about the unfairness of some devastated childhood situation, like not getting my favorite kind of cereal. "Mom, why can't we have Lucky Charms for breakfast, lunch, and dinner?" Or my sister, Laura, who happens to be enormously adorable, when we would go trick-or-treating, we'd do the count of candy at the end. She would always win. Oh, I would stomp around angry, sure that my actions would attract the attention of some divine referee who would step in and make the situation right, or at least acknowledge that an injustice had been done. Like Jonah, when I asked if my actions were reasonable, when others asked me, "Is this appropriate behavior?" I would say, "Of course! This is so unfair! I wish I didn't exist anymore, or other silly and oftentimes hurtful things to the people I felt wronged by. It is easy to dismiss Jonah's actions here as over the top, childlike, a massive temper tantrum that points to the use of this story as satire. But the truth is, my friends, this is radical theology dressed up in humor. And serious human behavior played out in an amusing and distant storytelling type way that we might then consider our own thoughts and actions and desires, our own judgments about what should and should not happen in the world. So, I wonder if you can think about a time when you have been upset or frustrated about something that, in hindsight, was perhaps not nearly as important as it seemed in the moment. This isn't a question about the big stuff that gets you frustrated, because Lord knows there's a lot of that out there. But I mean the small things, the things that just yank your chain. For me as an adult, it is almost always traffic. I get so frustrated driving. I work really hard to not do it, but man, my pet peeve, I put that left blinker on, right? I put it on so that you know to let me in. And instead you speed up so that I can't move over, as if somehow me being in front of your car is going to ruin the rest of your drive home. Oh, friends, don't get me started on traffic. So that's an example. I want you to take a moment and turn to your neighbor and share something that gets you frustrated that isn't actually a big deal. Go. All right, my friends, take a moment to find a good stopping place for this conversation. Don't you just know we could go on with this one all day long, right? So what kinds of things get you frustrated that you would be willing to share and are appropriate to the church setting? Oh, politics. Oh, man, the news right now. Oh, amen, Rick. All right, what else? Yes. Oh, losing your phone, right? And sometimes you put it in your purse and it is lost, right? And then it's like, no, it's not, but yes. What else? What else? What is it? Oh, man, computer problems, right? Then you ask for help. Well, did you turn it on and turn it back off again? Yes. That's not the issue. What else? What is it? Oh, passwords. Lord, have mercy, right? Oh, so many things. So for Jonah, the thing that just yanks his chain in the story today seems to be this plant. Now, God sends this plant to grow up over him and give him shade, and Jonah is utterly delighted. It must have seemed like a divine blessing. Here he is on a hillside outside Nineveh, waiting for what he hoped will be Nineveh's destruction. I can see him eating popcorn. There wasn't, but I imagine that. After having a major fight with God, We have finally learned why Jonah didn't want to go to Nineveh in the first place. And it isn't what we might assume, that he was afraid of what might happen, or that he was afraid of success or some other reasonable thing. He tried to flee to Tarshish, as he says, because I knew that you are a gracious and merciful God, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love and relenting from punishment. Jonah didn't want to go to Nineveh because he didn't want salvation to come to Nineveh. How perfectly human. Here is an enemy nation which is so evil, God has decided to destroy it from the face of the earth. But before doing so, God decides to give these people one last chance, and he sends Jonah. And the people, as we heard last week, they change. They offer up penance and they repent. They turn completely from their evil ways. And this turning is not just the people. It is the entire order of creation in Nineveh, transformed by the word of God. People and animals. And Jonah, he is angry. Instead of getting what they deserve, they get grace and forgiveness, because that is how grace and forgiveness works. And Jonah lodges his complaint before God in as strong of terms as possible. Venomy, God, he states. And God asks Jonah, is it right for you to be angry? But Jonah, as Jonah doesn't respond to God. Instead, Jonah refuses to do anything except go outside of the city of Nineveh, hoping that his angry diatribe to God will change God's mind once more, perhaps hopeful that ultimate justice will prevail, perhaps convinced that his ultimatum with God will change the situation. But no. Nineveh continues to be spared. God continues to be, in God's nature, merciful. And Jonah, who does not die, dwells in his anger. He dwells in his anger. Scripture tells us he builds a booth. This is like building a tent. He is camping out with his anger. Like Cain. In the story of Cain and Abel, those two brothers who arrive in the beginning of Genesis, aware that his anger is getting the best of him, even after God says, be careful, your anger is evil and it is lurking at your door, Cain continues to allow his anger and jealousy to build to the point where in his passion, he kills his brother. So here, in this story, Jonah simply allows his anger to fester. Now, we all know that there are positive outlets for anger, and stewing in it in the desert alone is not one of them. So God, in an attempt to reach Jonah, to transform his heart, God sends this plant. Not to stop Jonah's anger, but to try to teach him a lesson about the value of life and the reality of death. God sends a bush, and it grows up, and it gives Jonah shade, and Jonah is utterly delighted with it. He is as happy as can be for the first time in this story. But then the next day, God sends a worm, a creature that eats the plant, and it withers and dies, leaving Jonah exposed to the sun. And then God sends a hot wind to blast Jonah. And rather than doing something reasonable like getting up and going into the city to seek cool shade or moving to another spot that might have protected him from the wind, he prays to God, just let me die. And God asks Jonah, are you angry about the bush? And Jonah says, yes, to the point of death. He is so angry about this bush that it consumes him so that he can see absolutely nothing else. And friends, such is the function of our anger and hatred, right? It grows inside of us if left unchecked until it consumes everyone and everything else in our lives. Until it makes the very living of life unbearable. Jonah is so bound up in his anger and hatred of the whole world around him. And then Jonah says something that the English translation loses entirely. In God's opening response to Jonah in this moment, he says, "You are concerned about the bush for which you did not labor and which you did not grow. It came into being in the night and it perished in a night." The Hebrew word here that is translated as concerned is actually the word for pity. And not pity the way we think about it, like, oh, what a shame, but deep and lasting and abiding care for something else. Jonah had this deep and lasting abiding care for this bush and now for its death. That is what God is drawing out here. And for the first time in this entire narrative, God reveals to us that Jonah is not just some human being wrapped up in endless self-pity and narcissism. He cared about the well-being of this bush, and it died. And God asks him, "Should I not be concerned about Nineveh? That great city in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also many animals?" Again, the word here is pity. God has deep and lasting care for Nineveh, not just the people, but the entire scope of creation living in the city, its animals as well. To this question, there is no written and recorded response in the book of Jonah, because it is here that we learn that Jonah is not just the character of the story. He is actually us. We are the ones God is asking, "Should I not care for my own creation and all the beings within it?" What seems like a temper tantrum about a trip that did not go at all the way Jonah wanted it to turns out to be the outside view of a profound theological invitation for us to care about this world and all the people and all the creatures in it as God cares for us. It is a critical time to hear this message. To realize that while we as humans have our biases and our opinions, our enemies and our grudges, our tempers to manage, our justices to uphold, and when all of our compassion is burned out and all of our pity is lost, we have our wars to fight. God is looking at all of us, all this world, all the beings of creation, and seeing only God's own children, God's own work, God's own beloved. And God is asking us through the use of this bush in this story about a reluctant prophet swallowed by a fish to realize that we need to see the same. If God is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, relenting from punishment, friends, shouldn't we be the same? Amen. Amen. Friends, having spent some time talking about Jonah and thinking about the places in our own lives where we are in need of reconciliation, let us begin the practice by rising and greeting one another with the sharing of the peace of Christ and the welcoming. Hey God. Now, my friends, having greeted one another with signs of peace, let us turn to all those who are joining us online and say a hearty peace be with you. Peace be with you. And now, my friends, let us be seated as the ushers come among us to receive our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
Almighty God, these are the gifts of we, your people, that we might be a people moved more by compassion than frustration. Use these gifts as you use us to be words of peace, hope, and joy throughout your world. And all God's people declared of one heart, amen. Amen. And now, my friends, I invite you to please remain risen as we celebrate the Lord's Supper together. A few things to share. In the ancient tradition of the church, standing was one of the highest honors you could do. And so we remain on our feet to celebrate the presence of God among us. Please know that all the elements that are available here today are gluten-free and dairy-free. And if you are unable to come forward to receive communion, we will bring it to you. Just wait until the line has receded and then we'll come down. And so, my friends, the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right, and it is a good and a joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You shaped us from the dust of the earth and breathed life into us, forming humanity in your own image. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join the unending hymn saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, his death, and resurrection, you gave birth to us, your church. You delivered us from the slavery of sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which Christ gave himself up for us, Jesus took the bread. He gave thanks to you. He broke the bread, and he gave it to all of his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Every time you eat, eat in remembrance of me. And when the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you, and he offered it to his disciples, saying, Drink from this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant poured out in my blood. Every time you drink, drink in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered together and on these gifts of food and drink. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his love. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. My friends, you may be seated as those assisting with communion come forward. Friends, come. All is ready.
Please join me in the prayer Jesus taught his disciples and us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
friends, I invite you to turn to one another and share with each other this benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. And all God's people cried out, Amen. You may be seated for the postlude.